Hello, good morning, and welcome to Trinity Bible Church's online platform. My name is Pastor Caleb, and I am the Associate Pastor of Family Ministries at Trinity Bible Church. If you're looking and interested in any other resources that Trinity Bible Church has to offer, be sure to check out trinitybiblechurch.ca, and we have all kinds of resources for kids, youth, and in other areas. So be sure to look into that. Now, I am completing our series on Offstage as we look at the importance of integrity when it comes to our lives. Now, this week we're looking at the importance of integrity when it comes to what we think about in our lives. And so we're going to be in Philippians chapter 4 today. And as we approach and before we read Philippians chapter 4, I think it's important for me to mention that it's so easy for me personally to get distracted all the time. Sometimes I feel as if I'm one of those dogs out of the movie Up. Now, I don't know if you've seen the movie Up or not, but it's a funny Disney film and where we have these dogs with these automated specialized collars. And these specialized collars allow them to speak in human language. And so constantly throughout the movie, we have all these interesting things going on and some serious things. And then we have these funny looking dogs with these collars that randomly say squirrel. And so constantly throughout the movie, they're having a casual conversation. Hey, how are you doing today? Squirrel. Hey, I think we need to go there because we need to squirrel. And so constantly they're being distracted and it's pretty hilarious in the movie. Well, sometimes I feel like that on a daily basis as I'm getting distracted by whether it be YouTube, by TV, by my phone, by all kinds of things that can take my attention. Now, I don't know if that's a struggle for you, but I imagine that can be a struggle for many of us in the world we live in today. We live in a world that is filled with all kinds of distraction. Kids, did you know that your attention span is less than that of a goldfish? And you know what? Not just you, your parents too have an attention span that is less than a goldfish. And so we've had recent studies that look back at the year 2000, where our attention span used to be on average 12 seconds. And our attention span has decreased from the year 2000 to around 8 seconds, which is, by the estimation of scientists, 1 second less than that of a goldfish. Wow, we have less of an attention span than a goldfish. Now, there's all kinds of theories that we can come up with to explain why this is the case. And I think there's some good thoughts as we think about technology and the millennial age that we're in. But I think ultimately we should be looking to what God has to say in His Word. And as we look at that, that will help us understand the importance of focus in a world filled with distractions. So let's look to Philippians 4 verses 1 through 9 this morning. Philippians 4 verse 1, Paul writes this: "Therefore, my brothers, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm thus in the Lord, my beloved. I entreat Euodia and I entreat Syntyche to agree in the Lord. Yes, I ask you also, true companion, help these women who have labored side by side with me in the gospel together with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. Wow. Well, as we think about this passage today, let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the truth of your word in Philippians. And we just pray that you may guide our hearts as we learn from you this morning. In your name, amen. Now, as we think about Philippians, if you know anything about Philippians, you know that it is a book about joy. In Philippians, we see joyful unity within a Christian community. And this is a Christian community that is grounded in Christ. And so, as we think about this, our main desire today is to understand what is Paul's main idea and what he's communicating in this passage. And so this joy that we're going to look at as we understand Philippians as a whole, it doesn't mean, let's say, a fakeness when it comes to how we are on a Sunday morning. We can sometimes pretend that we're better than we are, or that everything's going okay when it's not. It doesn't mean that. Rather, the joy that Paul is talking about in the book of Philippians is talking about a strength that we have in all circumstances. It's not like a branch swaying side to side, being tossed by the wind. Rather, it's like a tree that is rooted in the ground and that has that strength. And so that's what we're thinking about when we think about joy in Paul's book in the Philippians. And so in verse 1, Paul says, therefore. And when he is saying therefore, he is referring to chapter 3, in which he talks about because of our belonging in Christ, because of who we are in Christ that will never change, because of that, therefore, we need to stand firm. And so as we stand firm, it comes back to this idea of being rooted in Christ. It's having this strength that can come from our joy in Christ. And with this, Paul encourages them to have unity in verses 2 and 3. And in verse 4, he encourages them to rejoice and to continue rejoicing. But he doesn't stop there. He directs us all to not be anxious, but to look to God who can provide this amazing peace that surpasses our understanding. And then he draws us to verses 8 and 9. And I don't want us to miss this, because this is important for us as we seek to understand it for our lives today. In verse 8, Paul says, finally. And then he lists these 8 things that we should be thinking about, things that we should be focusing on and that should completely capture our attention. Maybe one way to think about this is to think about a camera. Now, we have our phone cameras today, but we also have normal cameras. Some of us have normal cameras. And the important thing about a camera is the camera has the purpose of capturing the picture of something that you want to look at. And when you want to use a camera properly, you of course want to take this off and so that you can focus in the right direction. And you want to direct it towards what you want to take a picture of. But then you want to make sure that your hand's not covering the lens. And you also want to make sure that you are able to focus it so it's not a blurry picture. Now, this is the same idea when it comes to what we need to do. When it comes to these 8 things that Paul is drawing our attention to, we need to focus on them, not focus on bad things that can distract us away from what God wants us to look at, but things that direct us to where God wants us to focus. And so, as we think about this, this can be tough. We can imagine that this can be a tough way to live our lives because it's not natural. It's hard and it's challenging. But it comes back to this strength that is rooted as we understand our joy in Christ. And as we understand where we are in Christ, we can seek to focus on whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, all these things of excellence, anything that is worthy of praise. Now, you may find this unnecessary. You may say, you know what, why do I need to think about this list? You know, maybe this is an unnecessary thing to do. I have all kinds of other things that I can think about. But I want you to imagine your mind being a sort of jar like this. And so our minds, some of us, as we think about this, our minds may be bigger than this jar. You know, we may understand or be able to contain more concepts. But the thing is as we fill things in our mind, we have little things, but we also have big things. And over time, it takes up more and more space. And over time, if we put so much into this jar, we can be overwhelmed with all kinds of things that we're thinking about. And sometimes we want to just jam pack this jar when it comes to our minds that we become so distracted and so overwhelmed by what's going on in the world around us. And that could be a scary way to live your life. And so Paul is challenging us and saying, you know what? Be careful what you think about. Be careful about what you're focusing on, because that takes up space. And if you focus on anything, I want you to focus on some of these things. I want you to focus on these 8 qualities. I don't want you to be distracted every 8 seconds. I want you to be thinking about this. And so we think about what is true. And what we think about when it comes to truth is so important, because we can be so easily distracted by gossip and what is false, what are rumors, what is so easily stealing our attention when we look at the news and when we look at the world around us. And so this means that we need to take the time and effort to make sure that what we understand and what we think about is actually true. And sometimes you and I, when it comes to this idea of anxiousness that Paul mentions before this, you and I need to be challenged not to be distracted by the what ifs, but to focus on what is true in our lives. Next, we think about what is honorable. And so this gives us the idea of things that we can have deep respect for. We often give honor or respect to those who have really given their lives or sacrificed themselves for a great cause. They deserve honor. We're to think also about what is just. We're thinking about what is just, meaning what is morally right, what is the right thing to do. And this can be a challenge, especially in today's world where everyone has their flavors or opinions on what is right and what is wrong. And yet we are challenged to not be swayed to the right or the left, but we're challenged to align ourselves with what God says is right, what God says is just. Then we look to, as we see this list, we look to what is pure. Purity seeks to not sin a little here and sin a little there, you know, just to do whatever you want as you feel. But it means that we try to live lives that aren't influenced by sin. We seek to do what is right and to not do things that can so easily draw us towards sin, not to watch things or read things or be influenced by people who draw us away from God, but be influenced by people who draw us toward God. Beyond that, Paul directs us to think about things that are lovely. To think about lovely things, to think about beautiful things. Maybe for you, that's an amazing sunset that points to God's creation. Maybe it's a masterpiece. Maybe it's an individual that you care so much about that is completely beautiful to you, that is lovely to you. Beyond that, we're also to think about things that are commendable. Another translation of that is admirable. Things that are really things that we can be amazed by in our lives. Things that we can admire in a really impactful way that points us to God. Beyond that, Paul then directs us to look at things of anything of excellence. And so this idea of excellence really points to look at things of virtue. It gives us this idea of another way of looking at morality, of not just what is just, but what it means to live a life that is just. And so it points to people who are living morally right lives. And so we look to those people, we look to what they are doing, and we allow that to influence our own thoughts and how we live personally. And lastly, Paul directs us to look to what is worthy of praise. What is so significant that it captures your attention in such an incredible way? What is worthy of your praise in a certain situation, something significant to you? That is what Paul is telling us to think about and to focus on. Now, it is unlikely that this list is meant to be comprehensive. And this list rather is pointing us in the right direction. But you see, it could be so easy for each and every single one of us to rip this list out of context when it comes to the book of Philippians. We can do it in a bad way that dishonors God and undermines his grace in our lives. A way that we can do this is to pick this up and say, you know what? You know, I think I'm truthful enough, right? I think I have some honor to me. People respect me. I think I'm pure enough. At least I'm better than the person next to me. Of course, I'm more lovely than the person next to me. And we think about all these different things, and we think about it as a mental checklist, one by one, that we look over. And if we do it this way, we are missing the point of what Paul is trying to communicate. And we're thinking in a way that is similar to how the Pharisees thought. And the Pharisees were hypocrites who manipulated the rules in a way that made them look good and undermined who God was in their lives. Now, that is not the purpose of what Paul is trying to do here. Rather, Paul is trying to do something much more important when it comes to who we are and who God is. This is supposed to help us realize, as we look at Philippians as a whole, that we are failures. We mess up all the time. There's no way that we can properly think about all these things. These are things that draw us towards something. And it's not meant to draw us towards ourselves, where we look at this list and say, you know what, I can affirm myself. These are things that I have done in my life. Rather, this list is meant to point us to God. Because as we think about this list, we find something that is amazing. We realize that this list, its ultimate expression is in God himself. God is the ultimate truth. God is the most honorable, just, pure, lovely being who is commendable and worthy of all excellence and praise. That is who God is. And so, kids, if you are struggling and you're looking at this list and you're saying to yourself, man, this is so much to think about, I want to encourage you to not be nervous, to not be overwhelmed, but to say, you know what? I can focus on who God is. And as I understand more of God is, I can understand the importance of what truth is. As I understand who God is, I can understand what it means to be just, what it means to be lovely. You see, the more we learn about God, the more we can reflect these qualities and understand what it means to live these out. And that's where Paul directs us in verse 9 here. Paul says, what you have learned and received and heard in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. And so this points us to the practical thing. The important part is remembering that our thinking affects our actions. If this jar was to spill over, it would spill over and these things would fall out. And so in the same way, when we have those tough situations in life, when we're kind of knocked side by side, what's pouring out of us? Is it anger? Is it jealousy? Is it envy? Or is it love? Is it truth? Is it things that are honorable? things that are just. You see, that reflects, especially in times when things are tough, that reflects what you are truly focusing on in your life. And so we are called to reflect these qualities in our life, but not to be overwhelmed in a way. We are to understand that we reflect these qualities as we understand who God is in our lives. And as we do this, we can be strengthened in knowing that we are empowered by what God has done through Jesus Christ. Because Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, as we see in John 14:6. And Jesus has done all, really, he's done so much for each and every single one of us. And we see that displayed on his sacrifice on the cross. So the question for all of us today is, how can you and I be doers of the word when it comes to this? First, kids, I want to challenge you this week, this month, to learn more about God in his word, to read the Bible, to read even the book of Philippians. Maybe you can read the book of Philippians this week. It is a wonderful book. But I also want to challenge you in another area. I want to challenge you to ask more questions, ask curious questions about God. You can ask your other family members, ask your parents about God, ask them tough questions. What's God's favorite color? What's God's favorite animal? Who made God? How do we know that God exists? These are important questions to ask, and sometimes your family members and your parents may have answers to these questions and sometimes not, and that's okay because it's helping us learn more about God. Parents, I want to challenge you when it comes to really teaching and pouring into your children. Remember that you are one of the most influential people in their life today. So make sure that you are maybe leading them when it comes to their devotions. Make sure that you are guiding them when it comes to your time together as a family in reading the Bible. Make sure you know what videos they're watching, what they're learning from, what books they're reading, because that can be really impactful for them. And everyone, I want to challenge all of us to be learning more about God as we watch videos, as we read the Bible, as we read Christian books and do Christian Bible studies. These all help us learn more about who God is and how amazing he is. But of course, let's not stop there. Let's practice these things in our lives. Let's live them out in such a way as we live lives of integrity that focus on what is true and all these other qualities that ultimately are expressed in Christ. And as we do that, as we actually live these things out and practice these things in our lives, I am confident that God will do powerful things in and through us, and our community will see that and become impacted. That is an amazing thing that can take place through what God is doing through me and you. All right, let's take a moment and let's pray together. Lord God, thank you for today. Thank you for what you're doing in our lives. And we just pray that as we learn more about you, as we understand these qualities that point to you, that we may not be overwhelmed, but that we may fill these things in our minds as we look to you and as we treasure you. And may we be people of integrity. May we be people who are just. May we be people who are lovely. All for you and your glory. In your name, amen. Wonderful. Thank you so much for joining me this morning, and I hope you have a wonderful week. God bless.